Hello students, in last lecture we have seen the details regarding historical background of company law. Before that I would like to explain that today we will study about the Companies Act 2013 for BCCA 6th SEM and the subject is Company Law and Secretarial Practice. In earlier lectures, we have seen in detail regarding the meaning, concept, definition and different characteristics of company. What is the meaning of company? The definition given by some authors and the definition of Companies Act for the company means what the Company Act 2000 defined as a company. Then we have gone through with the different characteristics of the company, and these characteristics are essential to understand the further topics which are included in the syllabus. So, as we have seen the historical background, and what was there in the historical background? It was how slowly and gradually each company act has been revised with certain amendments, and those amendments were recommended by the stakeholders, by the owners who are in the business activities, means the lacunas or the difficulties which they were facing in the running of the business, that has been first of all identified, then it was considered, then recommended by them, and finally those recommendations were made in the form of amendments in the prevailing Companies Act. So right from the first Indian Companies Act 1850, we have seen the Company Act 2013, and now here we are here in the Company Act 2013. Now how it came into existence, what are the compulsory things for making that company bill or to convert the company bill into Companies Act? Okay, first of all, it was mandatory, it is mandatory that the bill must be passed from both the parliament houses, that is from Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So with reference to the Companies Act 2013, the company's bill which was passed in Rajya Sabha on 8th August 2013 and likewise the same and the another parliament house, that was Lok Sabha, it was passed in Lok Sabha on 18 December 2012. So, and the final consent must be given by the president. So considering the rules and regulation, the consent which was, the assent which was given by the president of India on the date 29th August 2013 and forward, means from the next day of the 29th August 2013, the company bill known as 2011 company bill get converted into Companies Act 2013, and the prevailing means even now the existing Company Act is Companies Act 2013. So what are its features? Companies Act 2013 is having 29 chapters, 470 sections and 7 schedules. Okay, on 29th August 2013 President gave its assent to the Company Bill 2013, and after 29th August 2013 that bill came into existence, and every business owner, every entrepreneur who wants to enter into the business must follow the norms which are mentioned in the Companies Act 2013. Now here we will see some landmark provisions in the Companies Act 2013. Now why it is called a landmark provisions? As we have discussed in historical background, that when there were some recommendations, some difficulties or some lacunas which was in existing act, okay, so to rectify all these, maybe there were some inclusions, means the additions were made in every prevailing Companies Act. So here the Companies Act 2013 is an advanced version of Companies Act 1956, okay, that you have to remember. First, the act came, and in that we have seen the one of the act which was prevailed for the 50 years. Even the Companies Act 1956, the gap between Companies Act 1956 up to Companies Act 2013. After every regular 10 years or 5 years, there were recommendations, okay, received from the members of the parliament or from the other persons like stakeholders or the business owners. But finally, it came into existence in the form of Companies Act 2013. So this is, we can call it is a comparison between or comparison of Companies Act 1956 with Companies Act 2013. What were the additions, what were the landmark provisions which were not in existing of Companies Act 1956, but amendments or certain additions, many of the terms, many of the norms, many of the rules and regulations which are introduced newly in the Companies Act 2013. There are 20 to 22 landmark provisions, and those 22 points I will provide you in the study material, in the study notes. But here today we will discuss the important landmark provisions in Companies Act 2013. So the very first, that is OPC, Small Government Company. This OPC stands for One Person Company. This is a very new concept which was introduced in the Companies Act 2013. So what is that? The word itself is self-explanatory. One person company. Even a single individual, a one person can own a company. Before that, what was the term? A sole trader. A single individual is known as a sole trader or a proprietor who can run the business. But here, there are certain rules and regulations, norms, which must be followed by this one person company. But the main idea or the main concept behind this new term is that a single person, a single individual can start his own business. He can enter into the business. Then he is also known as a promoter. So the concept of the promoter is also introduced in Companies Act 2013. But the main provision or a main landmark provision which was made in this act, that is one person company. It is also known as a small or dormant company. Now, small associate or dormant company. Even a single individual can handle the business activities. He must be a Indian citizen or he must be a resident of India. That was the only rule for opening a one person company. Okay, then the next is the maximum limit for opening this OPC, a small or a dormant company, that vary. It may be from 50 to 200 members. That the same similar things are mentioned in different kinds of companies, that is public company and private company. That we will see later. But here the concept of one person company was introduced in Companies Act 2013. Then resident director. Every entrepreneur must have, means it was the provision made in the Companies Act, that there must be a resident director in each company. Now, this resident director, the act provides that every company shall have at least one director who has stayed in India for total period of not less than 182 days. Means he must be residing in India for more than 182 days. Okay, it means more than 6 months or 8 months or 9 months. But he must complete the 182 days circle. Then only he can be called as a resident director for a company in which he is working. Again, there is another concept known as woman director. Now, this act also provides that certain class or a classes of a company. Again, there is a limitation that which kind of company can keep a woman director. It is not necessary that every business should keep, but this act provides that certain companies are having some rules and regulations for opening the company must have at least one woman director in their managing body, in their board of directors bodies. Then another is financial KMP, that is key managerial personnel. Again, this is a like OPC. Okay, this was the first time the new term or the new concept only made in Companies Act 2013. Before that, means till the Companies Act 1956, there was no idea or no concept of one person company was there. Likewise, key managerial personnel. This is also new, that key managerial personnel. Now this is known as KMP. Like here the short form is OPC, here it is KMP, Key Managerial Personnel. Now Key Managerial Personnel, what it means? The new concept was introduced in Companies Act 2013. These KMP means this is not a person or a personal, but this is personnel, key managerial personnel. And these personnel may be in the form of managing director, they may be a CEO, that is chief executive officer of the company, or they may be a company secretary, or there may be a chief financial officer. Means two or three new terms, that is managing director, okay, chief executive officer, okay, then company secretary or chief financial officer, that is CFO. And see, if you go through in detail in Companies Act 2013, the new concept of the business, that is multinational companies, okay. So as the business is growing, as the industrial revolution at its peak, so at that time different concepts which are maybe the part of the English Companies Act, as we have seen in historical background that each Indian company act have their base of English Company Act. So now to make our business on a global level, okay, as FDI, foreign direct investments, this is all a part of what, why there is a need to add such kind of terms in the Companies Act 2013. The idea behind this is only that our business should grow, it should reach the person who is sitting in Kenya also, in the other country. They also, they should use or they might use the product of our company. And this is all just for the growth and development of the business point of view. Certain terms are added, included in the Companies Act 2013. So key management personnel may be in the form of MDs, that is managing director, chief executive officers, that is CEO, then chief financial officer, that is CFO, or company secretary, means the person CS, okay. And earlier or by the time we are only aware about the CA, chartered accountant, but in nowadays the business has the equal importance to CS, that is company secretary, okay. So if an individual is a CS, he has a degree of CS, he is a CS holder, so he can be called as a key managerial personnel in the company, correct. Then secretarial audit report. So before that, means there was no necessity, means company, it was not compulsory for the companies to provide or to prepare their secretarial audit report, but in the Companies Act it was guided, it means it was included that the secretarial audit report, as the company secretary was known as a key managerial personnel, so there is addition of secretarial audit report, that every company must submit their secretarial audit report for the purpose of easy and clear financial activities for our each and every company. So every listed company and every company belonging to the other class of company may be prescribed shall has annex with its board report secretarial audit report given by the company secretary. Means who will provide this report? Company secretary. He has the control over that secretarial audit report. So financial statements. Earlier the balance sheets or the profit and loss account, okay. So the collective term, they have made the balance sheet and profit and loss account, means every company should provide their financial reports, their different calculations related to the finance, that is known as a financial statement. And these financial statements includes balance sheet and profit and loss account. But what the law says, the Companies Act have termed these two ideas, that means two financial statements, they are collectively known as a financial statements. Instead of calling it as a balance sheet or profit and loss account, they have given a new term, a new phrase to these two terms, that is financial statement. Okay, means balance sheet and profit and loss account is even compulsory now. The business owner must prepare their balance sheet and profit and loss account. But this balance sheet and profit and loss account is known as a financial statement of the company. Then rotation of auditors. Auditors must be rotated. It means after every 5 years, the company must change their auditor. Because why there was a need of certain provision, because the companies, they know our auditors, they were making some manipulations in their audit reports, in their financial statements, but they have made it compulsory. The Companies Act 2013 made it compulsory to avoid the fraud, to avoid any bad activities or any things which is going to put the businessman into loss. To overcome from that, the rotation of auditors. Auditors must be changed after every 5 years. Then mandatory internal audit. The internal audit was mandatory from the whose point of view? From the financial point of view, that they must submit, the company must submit the internal audit, and that audit must be done by the persons who have cleared a certain qualifications. Auditors, the persons who are pursuing the degree of CA, they can also do the audit work, means they are also called auditors if they pass the internal intermediate exam of that, means after completing that particular educational qualification, still the auditors, they must have the rotation of the auditors, and internal audit is mandatory. By the time before in Companies Act 1956, it was no compulsion. The internal audit was not necessary or mandatory, but in Companies Act 2013, internal audit is mandatory. Then vigil mechanism. Now what is this vigil mechanism? This is known as establishment of vigil mechanism. It means whistleblowing by every listed company, such class of companies as may be prescribed. This provision will help to encourage the ethical corporate behavior among the employees of the companies. This is completely a legal term, vigil mechanism. Means whistleblower, if something wrong is going to happen in the company, some illegal activities are taking place in the companies, then it is a job of CS or auditor that they must alert the business owners, and that should be avoided. This is known as vigil mechanism. So other landmark provisions, there are, as I've told you, there are 20 to 22 provisions in this Companies Act 2013, but the main provisions we have seen today. So we will stop here today regarding Companies Act 2013 and landmark provisions. In the next lecture, we will see another topic as per our syllabus. Thank you.